Thank you. praise, ye the Lord. Oh, praise ye the Lord. Oh, praise ye the Lord. Oh, praise, oh, praise ye the Lord. Oh, praise and say, oh, praise. Hallelujah!
Cordial, loving kindness. You drew Bye. Sing of the wonders of your grace. Hearts are open wide. Joy, you alone we seek, oh God.
shall sink our face. We shed your face when we sink, oh Lord. We sink you. We sink you. We sink you. We sink you, Father. Saints, let the sounds rise of praise. Let the thunderous sounds of praise arise. The army of the Lord, battle cry sounding forth. Awaken, 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 arise and arise and arise. To new horizons and territory. Going forth and conquering. So desperate for you, Father. We're so desperate for you, Lord. We're so desperate for you, Father. We're so desperate for you, Lord. Only for you. Only for you. Only for you. Only for you, Jesus. Only for you. Only for you, Lord. Only for you. Part of our soul, you make alive every part of our being. Quicken by, Lord, your glory so sweet, your presence so beautiful. More than anything we could ever seek after. More precious than precious jewels and riches. So sacred you are. So special to us. So dear. So dear you are, Lord. So dear. Bless the Lord. I hear the sound of praise. I hear the sound of praise arising in this place. I see a people passionate for the Lord. Jealous for good words. Jealous for good words. Make us more jealous for good works, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Lord. is so good. So mighty, awesome, merciful, and sovereign. So mighty, awesome, merciful, and sovereign. Welcome everyone tonight, this being the first of 3 days that we are so blessed to have Pastors Karen, Pastors Pat and Karen and Abby with us. Such a blessing. It's such a privilege and such an honor. Oh, we're believing God for such supernatural things that are going to happen. Such an explosion on the inside of everyone that comes in this place. Oh, the great things that God will do. Hallelujah. We can worship all night, but I want to introduce Pastor Pat, a man of such integrity, a man who's been a mentor, a leader in my life, who speaks the word with sharpness. And I love that the word goes forth through him. It's like, it burns like a fire because it's the word of God. The rushing water courses of heaven. Oh, thank you for tonight. I just want you guys to receive everything. Your heart to be so open that the word goes forth into such good and tender, soft soil that it brings forth much fruit and into the good ground of the hearts prepared by the Master. The things that the Lord has Pastor Pat doing right now. A voice to a generation. A voice to the church. And it's such a privilege to have him here with them, with us. We love him dearly.
The Lord told me to wait to the end on the offering. We were going to do that, but I can't do it. Come on, sing in the Holy Ghost. We're going to see what God does.
I feel your glory, Lord. I feel your presence. Feel your glory and I feel your presence. Ini ala la la de ya so de be yo ko.
My goodness.
I feel your glory and I feel your presence. I am so desperate for you. Sondere ya na na la la de ya ko la 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 de ya so ya. We receive you in this place tonight, God. We have no agenda tonight, God. Awaken your remnant tonight, Lord. Feel your glory. Simbe ya koya sa, hebe ya sa, simbe ya so ya ko, rebe ya so ya ya, kunderere ya si yoto. just want you. I just want you, Lord. Nothing compares to you. I just want you. Just want to know you. There is none like you.
Are you stirred in your spirit? Forgive me. I'm lost. Heaven invade this place. Heaven invade the earth. Let it be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us the keys, Lord. Hey, I'm going to have you do something. I want you to reach your right hand up. Matthew 16, 19 says, He'll give you the keys of the kingdom. That word keys is kleis. It's power and authority. But you have the power to bind and loose. Hear the sound of marriages being healed. You know, the Lord has said something 3 times to me, Kate and Ruth Anna, and that is that in your belly is a dancer. It's a dancer. A dancer. A David dancer. That's what the Lord just said to me. He just said, 3 times he said it, Kate. There's a dancer in there. There's a David dancer. Not a cultural dancer, but a David dancer, a warrior. A warrior that will dance before the Lord. Feel your presence, oh God. Feel your presence, oh Lord. Just a little bit longer. Just worship for a second longer with you. Feel your freedom, oh God. Lose your spirit, God. I want everybody under the age of 25 to just begin to glorify Him out loud. There's an awakening in this youth ministry. Come on! Feel your presence, oh Lord. Glory, oh God. You know, the Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 7 that it took Solomon 13 years to build the temple, but for the church in Oregon, it'd be 13 months. The Lord says He's going to do it so quickly, it's going to blow y'all's mind how that's going to come together. And yeah, it will be a glory post for the Lord. You know, before God moves across people, He's always moved across land. That means long before anybody ever grazed on that land or walked on that land or rode on that land, He was already standing there saying, they will worship Me here. And we say that about our own house. Long before our house was built 12 years ago in Birmingham, Alabama, He was already standing there saying, I'm going to put right in the middle of this neighborhood, this house right here, where there'll be about six now radical believers that are going to praise Me, even amidst the religion of the South and the racism and all the other junk that goes on. And in fact, it's our house is dead center in a former plantation, and because we know how to do Ezra and reclaim the land. And You know what I'm talking about? We can reclaim the land wherever we go. We can, anywhere I, if I walk through an airport, I'm reclaiming land. When I walk into a hotel room, I'm reclaiming that room. Because I know who I am. I'm a mobile upper room. When I walk into places, demons have to dive out windows. Something in me. I'm a temple. I ain't no shack. Take your for sale sign down and realize who you are. Nothing can touch you. No plight, no calamity. No arrow by day or night. You have the authority. If we ever step into the authority that God has released in our lives, you need to understand, there would be nothing that was impossible. Anyway. Is there a remnant in the house? All right. Give the Lord a praise. Give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. Thank you for tilling the ground and leading us in. You may be seated, and we'll do the offering for the vision at the end of the service. And thank you for those that have become partners with RaiseTheRemnant.com. We got a call today. It was so funny. Our staff at home was on a phone call with someone, and this is pretty cool because Pastor Mark was with me in Jackson, Georgia, not far from Atlanta. We saw a glorious move of God to like 1 a.m, just a crazy move of God. And Pastor Mark and Ann were with me, and one guy came up to us, and he had a prosthetic leg on, and we laid hands on him. He said, I believe my leg's supposed to grow back. And how many of you believe in when God can recreate, a recreating miracle? Are you with me? I believe in that. And we laid hands on this guy. We got a call today in our office. This guy called to tell us that he went back to the doctor because he was having trouble with his back, and he had his prosthetic leg on. And the doctor said, well, your leg has grown 2 inches. And so, isn't that cool? That's cool. I don't care what you say. That's cool. And Karen and I are so blessed to be here. Karen, come greet everybody now. Listen, you don't want to miss tomorrow night, because especially if you understand the power of hope and joy and authority, tomorrow night that's going to happen. And my gift from heaven is here. She just got back from Brazil, where she saw, just tens of thousands of touched women crying out to God and getting set free. But I brought my gift here, and she's going to be speaking tomorrow night. And so why don't you greet everybody? She's got a brand new book that just came out, Dehydrated. Don't get it. It'll mess you up. And don't get it, because we're getting too many reports from around the world about people's families being set free and wells being dug in their homes. Anyway, don't get it. Don't worry about it. But would y'all make Karen welcome, my gift?
Thank you. Thank you. It is such an honor to be here, to be in this house, to be in a place that really, truly still believes in the altar, that still believes in worship, that still believes in the altar call, that believes in the power of the Holy Spirit, that hasn't kicked out the Holy Spirit. And that only comes because you have the most incredible leadership that you could ever imagine here in this house with Pastor Mark and Ann Spitzbergen. And so we are so excited to be here. And as Pat said, that I just got back from Brazil, and I saw as around 15,000 women cried out for an encounter with God. But here's what I believe. I believe it's time that we stop having to go overseas to see a move of God like that. That we can see it right here, and we need it right here in our nation again. And so that's what this weekend is about. That is what I Am Remnant is all about, is seeing that move of God take place here in our nation again. And so you do not want to miss one bit tonight. You want to get your pens out. You want to get your paper out, because there is going to be a word that is brought forth that is going to spark a fire, that is going to be able to begin a birthing process in your life that is going to transform you by the power of the Holy Spirit. So just get ready.
Tomorrow morning, Pastor Mark and Ann will be coming home. And so, man, I've heard some crazy, really favor open doors and crazy stuff. And Karen, I hope you get to preach tomorrow night if they're here, because he'll get crazy. And I just looked over at little Anna sitting over there, and I saw her doing this, and she's writing love letters to the Lord. I mean, that's what the Lord said. And so... That's pretty powerful. But I'm very stirred. And I want to say a couple things before I get right to the word. In fact, you can go ahead and open your Bibles to Luke chapter 15, Luke the 15th chapter. And I'm going to get into this word. I don't know how long we're going to go. But I want to tell you that our vision for this year, the Lord spoke to me December 18th and 19th, sitting on this old, many of y'all know James Levesque. James had these old pews, and I got one at my house. It's from the Great Awakening Revival, and I would go sit on it. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, I'm going to shout in 2016. I thought that was crazy. I didn't know. Are you coming back, Jesus? Because, you know, the Bible says he's coming back with a shout. And then he said, no. When I begin to shout over my people, I drive the enemy back. And Psalms 84 verse 10 says that people take joy in the shout of the Lord. So we want the Lord to shout, amen. We wanted to push back the lies of the enemy. And the reason why I share that with you is please check that out at the table, that prophetic word. I didn't know it was 16 things, but 16 things will happen. Everything from household salvations breaking out, and we've seen it. Because we're believing for 100,000 souls this year as missionaries to America. And I had a prophetic vision of a giant homosexual dance, or they call them balls, that was taking place. And suddenly those that had been raised in the church, it's like the wind of God blew past them in a mist, and their eyes were uncovered. And they began to repent in the restoration, because the Lord spoke to me, I want my kidnapped children back. Are you with me? And we've saw that over the last few weeks. 2 weeks ago in Texas, a lady came running in, weeping and wailing, completely delivered from the lie of lesbianism. And if that offends anybody, we don't throw rocks, we throw ropes. We pull people out, amen? But I don't buy into cultural lies. And so part of the remnant movement is Romans 11 verse 5, so too at the present time there's a remnant chosen by grace. And you have to understand something, is the Lord spoke to me exactly on May 26, 4 years ago. In fact, last week he reminded me of it. And I was out jogging one day, and all of a sudden the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, and he said, I will awaken a remnant in America. And I said, Lord, I don't even know what that is. I know I laid carpet in high school and college, so I know that it's the leftover pieces that you can't use. I know it's the pieces that don't fit in. I know it means rag in the hand of God. I know in the Hebrew, the word remnant is what's left over after others have fallen away, been destroyed, or chased apostasy. Are you still with me? I know that the definition of remnant literally means what comes at the very end of a generation. And the next outbreak of God in America will not be people lined up outside for 2 days to get into a church service. I'm going to be straight up with you. It will be those that suddenly have an awakening, that will stand up in the middle of their neighborhoods and lead mom movements to take back the schools. It will be those that stand up and say, we've had enough. It will be those that stand up and say, you cannot pervert this any longer. You can't take and add to it. You can't preach half the scriptures anymore. It'll be those that don't just write love songs about the love and the grace of God, but also how you can be delivered from sin and perversion. Because we're raising a salt generation that loves worship more than word, because it soothes their demons. Now, is it okay if I get into this? Yes. Because you have to understand, for the last 4 years, Ecclesiastes 11 verse 1 says, cast your bread upon the water and it will return to you. Now is the return time. Now is the moment. Why? Because the Bible tells me in Leviticus, there's a scripture that talks about the fact that when you enter the land and plant any kind of fruit tree, regard its fruit as forbidden. Here's what a lot of people don't understand about launching business, and if you have that gift of faith that has come on you, 1 Corinthians 12:9, it's a gift you should ask for, eagerly desire the gifts. I have the gift of faith. I believe we're called to be blessed. If you don't believe in any of that, don't get the entrepreneurial anointing back there. The series God gave me a year ago, the first key he gave me to the kingdom. Because he said, I'm going to begin to give you keys. I had a prophetic vision of the Lord wearing this belt with all these keys on it. And he said to me, I'm going to give you keys. That's why I'm going to preach about the altar tonight, because he keeps giving me keys. One of the keys was how to, I know this sounds awkward and you don't hear from preachers when we should, how to lose weight. Because I got a race to run. But what you got to understand is this. It says, when you enter the land and plant any kind of tree, remember the Lord spoke to me exactly 4 years ago that we would see a remnant movement. And then we wrote, I am remnant, and it's number one in Korea, and God's using it all over the world. Then we wrote Unqualified, and Karen wrote Dehydrated, and I wrote a book with Sid Roth called It Sooner Than You Think about the rapture, what's going to happen, and all this other stuff. But the Lord began to speak to me, and he said, you do understand it's 4 years.
since I gave you the vision for Remnant. And I'm like, okay, Lord. And he showed me this, and he said that, you know, on the first 3 years, you're not supposed to touch any fruit from a tree. But in the fourth year, that's when you get to enjoy the fruit. So if you've ever launched a vision or anything, wait for the fourth year. That's why this year is such an important year. We're going to see 100,000 souls saved this year. Somebody give God a praise. Come on. And I'm not talking about some mass crusade where they just say something and they don't mean it. Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. If you study, that means heart surgery. We don't teach that anymore. We say a prayer and I'll go and act like the devil. That's got to stop. We're sanctifying demons because deliverance takes too long. Is it okay if I preach like this tonight? It's Pastor Mark's fault. It is. Greatest influence I've had in my life, probably ever, as far as a leader in my life, is Pastor Mark. Greatest voice I've ever met in my life. If he were to call me tomorrow and say, do this, I'd do all of it, every bit of it, because I trust the gift that God has given this house. So when I come here, I'm home. And so you got to understand, I got to get into this word, but I want to warn you that contents of this message is going to be harmful to your flesh. Just want to warn you. I do want to say to you that if you say, Pat, I want to partner with this vision, there's cards back in the back, and you can become a part of Raise the Remnant. You'll get a video every week and teaching every week, and only if the Lord speaks to you. But and all the books are back there, T-shirts, all that stuff. We came up with Remnant T-shirts because it's time to start walking through cities declaring who you are. Identity breaks curses. But anyway, that's something totally else. But let's get into this. See, I have learned that you can only preach where you survived. I don't want to hear theory. I want to see scars. Are you with me? Don't tell me what you think. Don't tell me what you believe. Show me. And so the Lord began to speak to me because I think the thing that grieves my spirit the most in America that would fix the abortion epidemic, that would fix so much of the identity crisis and all the other things. Like last summer when I began to preach, and seven ladies that had been lied to by the enemy about their sexual identity, 5 minutes into the sermon came running down and radically got delivered. Took their rings off to each other, broke up. Two of them are a part of RaiseTheRemnant.com. They're in our school. One's writing a book about how the devil's a liar. I'm going to write the foreword on that junk. But see, one of the things we don't understand about the anointing that it breaks the yoke, but the problem is we love the omnipresent of who God is, but we don't understand the omnipresence. And understanding that you can live in a state of the continual presence of the God of the Lord sweeping over you no matter what hell you're walking through, no matter what's coming against you. So follow me because I'm going somewhere tonight. In fact, I want to go ahead and say this, and you've heard me say this before if you've been in service with me. The altar is now open because we will see miracles. So if at any given point, because when humanity meets divinity, that's an altar call. At any given point, the Spirit of God overwhelms you and you go, you know what, Pat, I need an encounter. Ignore me. Just come. But I do want to warn you that there's about 3 or 4 feet in. There's a river because I stood in it tonight. And you're going to get tripped over that, okay? Just want to warn you. You might get a scab. But what you got to understand is I got to preach this word simply titled The Altar. The Altered. Is it okay if I preach? This might be a title of a book, but my publisher told me people don't buy books to repent anymore. Got to break up with them, but now watch. I want to go back to the place of freedom for a minute. One of my favorite chapters in the Bible is called the Lost Chapter. Long before ABC knew what lost was, God knew what it was. And reminded of the chapter when you look at Luke, the 15th chapter, and I'm going to say it now, but I'm going to come back to it later, so let me just set it up for you for a second. But it talks about the lost coin. It talks about the lost sheep and the lost son. It's the three reasons why people are lost. I do a whole teaching on the anatomy of lostness, understanding why people are lost. And the lost coin got lost because he was mishandled. The lost sheep got lost because he got busy and wandered off. And then the lost son got lost because he made decisions that led to his demise.
Those are the three reasons why people get lost. My favorite scriptures is found in Luke chapter 15, verse 20. It says, so he got up and he went to his father, but while he was still a long way off. That's my favorite. Because at 16, he walked into my bedroom and I saw him. I didn't think he was real because I'd been raised in religion. It says, while he was still a long ways off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. That word in the Greek there is splagchisnemo. I'm probably saying it wrong. I'm so glad Pastor Mark's not here. And when we walk out of services, go, let me try to say that right. I'm a redneck. I mean, I just read a script. I don't even study how the word. I just, like, that's the way it sounds. We're going to do it that way. Splagchisnemo, I believe is what it is. But it means to ache from within your bowels. You ever felt that way about your kids? I write about it in I Am Remnant when we almost lost our son. He was being recruited for football and all this stuff was coming into his life. He'd lived a godly life all the way to his senior year, and then all hell came against him, because if you're not coming up against the devil, you're flowing with him. And sitting Christians hatch hypocrites. So you have to understand, if you're not under attack, it's because you're not a threat. And the greater the anointing, the greater the isolation. And you have to understand something. He had gone through a season of isolation and all hell began to fight him. And I'll never forget the compassion, the aching inside. And now he's pastoring a youth ministry, one of the most powerful Holy Ghost youth ministries in America now. With 3 or 4 weeks ago, they had over 2,000 and on a Wednesday night. And so, but hell was fighting his destiny. And so I love where it says right here, when he was a long ways off, filled with compassion for him, he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Now, there's going to be more that comes to that, but we're going to do it towards the end. But what you got to understand, it's when we can no longer stomach the stench of compromise that we arise and run to the Father. Are you still with me so far? And I want to take you somewhere. I want to share a message tonight that in a lot of places in America, this would be considered old school. It would be considered out of touch. It would be considered just emotional platitudes. Guys, don't get it. You got to realize there's so many. About one third of my calendar I can no longer preach at. When I've been doing this for 18 years, traveled over 2 million miles, about one third of the places I can't go to anymore because what I have to preach, they don't want to hear, but that's okay. Because you've got to understand, Remnant is not the masses. Remnant is the group that rises up. Every move of God. What does it say about the disciples? The small group, it says they were known as those who turned the world upside down. Acts 17. In fact, you got to understand, most would probably think this is a type of message that needs to be kept under wraps for fear of endangering the comfort zone and the compromise, and thus reduce the finances in our church buildings that have amazing facades, but they're like Hollywood sets. There's nothing past the front door. The depth of God's presence is as thin as outer space. And what you got to realize is, in fact, many will say this type of message doesn't work today. It's old cloth. But I've seen the miracles. I seen when a young lady came up to me in Tampa recently, and she walks up to me after a three-day crusade, and she runs up to me and she said, Can I talk to you? And her name is Lauren, and all of a sudden she said, why are you preaching tonight? She said, my mom left us a year and a half ago and ran away. And it's me and my brother and my dad, and I began to cut myself secretly. And why are you preaching tonight? You said scars can disappear, and I looked down and mine were gone. The next day that night she calls her mom. Her mom drives home 8.5 hours. Comes to the service the next night, gets radically saved. We redid the wedding in the altar with mom and dad. So don't tell me my God doesn't still do miracles. Because I'll tell you about the young lady that walked up to Karen and I 3 weeks ago at our national conference. And she said, while you were preaching, I thought, I'll go check. She ran to the bathroom, pulled up her shirt, pulled down her pants because she secretly cuts herself in places. And she said, she came running out, ran to her youth pastor and said, it's true. All my scars are gone. See, I serve a God of the miraculous. I serve a God of healing. You say, well, why is that a big deal? We got people dying of cancer, Pat. We got this stuff. Because the enemy loves, if he can't kill him in the womb, get them to hate themselves. And God says, I'm going to restore the identity of a generation. That's what Remnant is all about. Oh, you're not getting this yet. That's fine. I've seen a little bit of Joel 2:28. I've seen tens of thousands running to the altar. In fact, I start to get offended at it because sometimes I don't get to finish a sermon and I'm like, Lord, it's very rude of them. But to be considered a dinosaur of ministry because you still believe in the altars and the gifts of the Spirit and the awakening is actually a compliment. Remember when dinosaurs died, they left oil behind. And it runs the cars of the next generation, so we're good to go. I love what Leonard Ravenhill said. He said, if Jesus preached like most preachers preach today, he wouldn't have been crucified. But I must preach about the altar. This is Pastor Mark's fault. I'll explain in a moment. So much is his fault. But I want to preach about this living, breathing, expanding thing. And thank you, Adam, for making this for me. It's hard to get that on a plane in the overhead. But what you have to understand, the remnant is the one who simply says yes to the cross and no to the applause, yes to the altar, no to arrogance, yes to covenant, and no to worldly concepts. So I must preach about the altar tonight. Is that all right?
Yes.
Because I'm about to start eating some of the fruit. We're in the fourth year, Leviticus 19. We were walking down the beach last week on vacation. I said to Karen, it's time for the fruit. It's time to eat of the fruit. We're going to see things we've never seen before. So I want you to write this down, friends. I want you to get ready because I'm preaching about the altered, and you have to understand. Write this down. Number one, tie me to the altar. You need to realize that as long as we are justifying our passions, we'll never rectify with the cross. And there comes a moment when God begins to change you. What do you mean, tie me to the altar? Look at Psalms chapter 1, verse 18. Last October, Pastor Mark and Ann flew in for our board meeting. There's about 12 leaders from around the world that are part of our board of directors. They come in. They're part of Remnant Ministries. They talk to us. They make sure we're okay. They check our finances. It's all accountability and a lot of other stuff. But we're walking out of a restaurant, and everybody's going back to the hotel. And all of a sudden, Pastor Mark said, the Lord's going to tie you to the altar this year. And that stuck on me. I did not understand what was that. I felt it. It lit my spirit up. But I knew I needed to go on a journey and study that. Kind of like when God began to speak to me about the gift of faith. Of 1 Corinthians 12 verse 9. That walking in faith. Not just in signs and wonders. But in finance and all of that kind of stuff. And realizing God wants you to have streams. And he wants you to invade and take from the enemy. Are you with me so far? Can I preach like this? I don't want to get to heaven with any part of my brain unused. All my report cards said most of it wasn't, but listen. But the Bible says in Psalms chapter 1 verse 18, looking at verse 27, God is the Lord and he gives us light. Bind the sacrifice with cords to the horns of the altar. I didn't understand this. I began to study it. What does it mean to be tied back to his presence? What does it mean to be tied to the altar? 2 Corinthians 5 verse 14 says, for it's Christ's love, it constrains me. That's like taking an oversized pillow and putting it in a small box. It means I take the shape of him. So when we talk about being tied to the altar, it's that place where you say, Lord, I never want to leave your presence. Nothing can pull me away from your love. No height, no depth. Nothing. It means suddenly I get back to that place where I'm strapped down to the place where I found freedom. It means I can't walk. Oh, I wish you'd get a hold of this tonight. It means I've made up my mind that I'm not going to be the wandering sacrifice. It means I've made up my mind that I will be there till the fire comes and consumes. Are you still getting this? See, I've never known anyone to see God and live. I know what it's like for him to walk into a hotel room at 1:30 in the morning after I had fallen asleep and said, Lord, I want to see you. And at 1:30, the glory filled the hotel room and I began to scream, don't come any closer or I'll die. I've never been that scared in my life. And I could see his hand and I could see his foot and he began to to say to me, Pat, if you'll give me everything, I'll give you everything. Tell a generation. If they'll give me everything, I'll give them everything. And I woke up and began to read John chapter 7. Ask, seek, and knock, which is a perpetual verb. It means never stop asking, never stop seeking, never stop knocking. It's the same thing as Isaiah 61 or Isaiah 6, where he says, who will go for me? That is not just for Isaiah. All Isaiah did was put his ear to the intercom of heaven. It means he's saying it right now. Who will go for me? Who will go for me? Who will go for me? He never stops saying. It's on. It's as if God's got scratched and the CD is skipping. Who will go for me? Who will allow me to tie them to the altar? Who will understand that the remnant are those that will no longer squander the daylight with things that do not matter, but live waiting for night to fall when men have fear in their hearts? That is when their light from God shines ever so bright as they climb upon the altar. It means I'm dead to sin and I'm alive in Christ. It means, that's what Pastor Mark says, the entire New Testament was a revelation of God to live and for me to die. It's that place of understanding that he constrains me. I can't do what I wanted to, that what I want to do. I can't do what the flesh wants to do. I am tied to this thing. I can't go out and chase fantasies because I'll find poverty, the Bible says in Proverbs. Instead, I am so at that place where if he whispers, I can hear it. If he shouts, I can run into battle. If he declares, I can be a part of the army. It's that place where I must participate in his sufferings. It's Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. I want to know Christ in the fellowship of his sufferings. Oh, I'm going somewhere. It's that burning and desires of Romans chapter 10. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, or understanding that it says, if how shall they go unless they're sent? How beautiful are the feet of him who brings the good news. See, I'm going somewhere. What birthed this message? Again, God gave me a vision. He had a belt on, all these keys. He said, Pat, ask me for the keys. And so one by one, he's been giving me the keys, and it's messing me up. That is a plural word, by the way. It's not just one key. There's keys. Yeah. That means when God walks by, you ought to hear clanging. He's the janitor. Makes you appreciate that old guy at your high school, doesn't it? But we must become frustrated. I'm being honest. I am finding myself so stinking frustrated. Not just because suicides amongst the age of 5 to 9s has tripled in the 5 to 9-year-olds in the last 10 years. Not just because our president has determined that those who play dress up can walk into the rooms where our children's dressed down. If that's offensive, there's a long line of people you got to get behind, so just wait. I'm being straight up. I mean, have you ever been frustrated? You can't explain frustration. There are some key leaders in this house that are very frustrated in a good way. And I'm telling you, I've got to prophesy in a minute. Because I'm learning the more you tell the truth, the smaller your crowds get. I mean, we're living in a time where if you're not preaching some hyped up grace message, because of the invasion of secular Christianity. Secular means void of God. Because we're raising up a headless bride. She's got a great body, but she's dumb. Celebrity Christians and all the different stuff. And Jesus said, I did not come with a feather, but I came with a sword. And I'm going to separate the sheep from the goat, and a goat will eat anything. And never turn your back on a goat because they'll hurt you. And Jesus said, you're either for me or you're against me. You're going to have to make a choice. And the spirit of this age is to make sin seem normal and righteousness strange. And Jesus said in Matthew 22, verse 14, that many are going to get invited, but not everybody's going to make it. And we don't like to talk about that, but the remnant will not bow to culture, but rather culture is recreated by their passion for Jesus. I want to offend someone's flesh so that they might walk into Jesus. See, there's a moment we must realize that if you're ever going to be used by God, you are called to live frustrated. Why? Because frustration and agitation are the mother of intercession. I'm going to say that again. Frustration and agitation are the mother of intercession. In fact, we also understand. I love what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 3. He declared it. And again, this is a new message, so forgive me if I'm stuck to notes, but I'm okay with it. But frustration is better than laughter, because a sad face is good for the heart. In other words, God says, I will frustrate you. I will frustrate you. I will frustrate you. Listen to me. You will never get frustrated as long as you're satisfied with your flesh. And your satisfaction with your flesh far outweighs your desire for his glory. You'll never get frustrated. It is those that live in a constant place of more, more, more. God, I want to see the lost saved. I don't even want to worry about this. I don't want to worry about that anymore, God. I just want to see that. I want to see the encounter. It's yesterday we took a day. We flew in and we went down to Disneyland and we're walking through and I see a fella sitting in a wheelchair. And the Lord said, do you have the faith to go yank him out? And I realized he said the exact same words to Karen. And I said, Lord, I do. I do, Lord. I believe I do. But my feet didn't believe it. But I feel the cry that is echoed by John the Baptist tonight. It's just kind of an understanding of what you don't really want to declare your remnant unless you understand this. I'm just going to tell you. Because Mark chapter 1, verse 3 is the voice of the cry of John the Baptist when he said, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord and make straight paths for him. Listen to me. I'll never forget about 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago, when the Lord gave me this message. I'm in the middle of writing it. I'm in my manuscript, because everything eventually becomes a chapter in a book. So I deliberately manuscript all my sermons. And my phone rings and I look down. It's Pastor Rodney Howard Brown. You don't ignore his call, because he'll keep calling. I'm going to tell you right now, he does. And so I answered the phone. It's Pastor Rodney. And all of a sudden, he just starts prophesying. He just starts going off. I mean, it was crazy. But I said, hold on. I'm typing. And he said this to me. He said, we must introduce them to God and arrange the meeting. Those that are faithful to the purity of God, the doctrine and the work of the Holy Spirit. And if they are desperate, they shall experience the move of God like no one has ever seen. Can I tell you what's been on my heart all week? What you saw in the 90s in San Diego and the move of God that you were a part of, this house was birthed. It was a part of this whole thing. It was what helped birth it. The Lord says, it's greater what is coming very soon. The Lord, all week long, he said, tell them to forget the 90s. I have something greater. And every 20 years, God pours out his glory. And you need to understand, he's uncapping the wells that man put on it. And you need to realize something is coming. And what you got to realize is we're in a very dangerous place right now, because I'll be honest with you, I don't even want to think. I don't want to think about anything but him. And you have to realize I have been called to lead a movement that I did not ask for. In fact, I do believe, listen to me, I do believe that God could have found someone way more available and qualified. That's why I wrote unqualified. Yet on the Dallas street, May the 26th, 2012, he said, Pat, I will awaken a remnant. I'm like, Lord, I don't even know what that is. But the remnant is movement is not for the faint of heart. It is those who are ready to crawl back to this altar and say, Lord, I'm not getting up until you do something that so messes me up. I'm not getting up to every perverse thought, every fear, every doubt. And if you're like David, you end up underneath it. And it's when you end up underneath this thing that it gets locked to you and you don't even realize he's tying you down. Somebody give him a shout. And I'll be honest with you, it's not for the celebrities, because the true newspaper press coverage of the called should always be an obituary of self and the birth announcement of spirit revival. Jesus started his ministry and ended it with one word, repent. Amen. We got to be those that burn for souls again. Amen. Jonathan Edwards, when he said, oh God, stamp eternity upon my eyeballs. When 100 people a minute go into eternity, 100 people a minute die, that's 1,440 minutes a day. That's 144,000 walking to heaven or hell every single day. You have to understand. My frustration, I said, God, why am I? I've lived for about 6 months this year, not under the cloud of oppression or depression. I've done that. I've talked about that. I've wrote about that. I got free of that dancing in Gettysburg 3 years ago. But anyway, Really did. I went and danced in Gettysburg. It's wait till tour buses see that. Karen's on the phone with me. I'm on FaceTime and I'm dancing in Gettysburg. Because the Lord said, go dance where others have died. See, what you call a tombstone, God calls a milestone. The place you thought you would die is the place you're going to dance the greatest. I got to be careful. I'm taking some of your stuff. Don't worry about it. If y'all see me tomorrow night when Karen's preaching and I go, that means she took something of mine. So if she starts laughing and y'all don't know what it's about, she's laughing at me because I'll go, really? But my frustration is from the Lord. Anybody been frustrated lately? Be honest, raise your hand. You're like, I got to see this thing. Come on, be honest. Can I tell you it's from God? Because the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 19 through 21, for the creation awaits an eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subject to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected in hope. The creation itself would be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and the gloriousness of the Lord. So you have to understand, God will take you through a place of absolute frustration because what used to please you cannot please you anymore because it's glory to glory. And between every glory to glory, there's a bridge called adversity. And so when God says, I'm going to take you from glory to glory, that means you're going to have to walk through some things because most of us are waiting on our win, not W-I-N, but our W-H-E-N. And Jesus was crucified between two trees, two thieves. Yesterday and tomorrow, they'll both steal from you, but he's right in the middle of our today. Are you with me? He says, I'll never leave you and forsake you. He said, don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will take care of itself. Matthew chapter 6. And so you have to understand when you're waiting on your win, when you finally get to the win, the W-H-E-N, when all of a sudden you see it, you're already thinking about the next win because God has never called you to sit and relax. He has called you to live in a place of frustration, understanding. I'll be honest with you. I'm worried about running past the throne when I get to heaven. Because I don't ever want to stop running. And I'm going to run into heaven. Everybody's going to be waving. I'm just running. You go, whoa, big boy, come right here. Because there's a moment where you've got to begin to realize this thing. We must not stop. Eternity is speeding up. We're racing against the rapture of the bride. Oh, I'm just going to preach. I'm preaching back there. I'm turning around. Because we need to understand. We must rebuild the place of encounter. I know I'm preaching to the choir tonight. I get that. But this is the call of the remnant, that we must rebuild the place of the encounter. That means in our homes, in our living rooms, in our backyards. That means a constant place. I'm talking about a call to weep again. We must curl up between an amen and there it is, where we say, God, I'm not moving till I see the breakthrough. I'm going to pray. I'm going to fight. I'm not going to appease my flesh. I'm not going to get into that. I'm right here. If we'll just rebuild the place of encounter. It's Joel chapter 1, verse 13. Put on the sackcloth, you priests, and mourn. Well, you who minister before the altar, come spend the night in the sackcloth, you who minister before my God, for the grain offerings and drink offerings are withheld from the house of your God. You have to realize we are so close to the death of a generation. I believe we are one generation away from the extinction of Pentecost. It was 2012 that the Lord spoke to me. There would be an awakening. I know I have 40 years. I have a generation. I know that something's got to happen between now and I'm 46 years old. I know something's got to happen right now before the next. You got to understand we're 4 years into it, 36 years from now. 2052, we're in trouble. Judges 2:10 talks about that. Remember, these are Joshua's grandkids. You know, as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Remember that? Saw the greatness of the Lord, the deeds of God. But it said after that, a whole generation, Judges 2:10 says, after that whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. We're there. Because we've watered the blood down so much, we've given the Holy Spirit a pink slip in so many of the churches. And Leonard Ravenhill said, the greatest miracle that God can do today is to take an unholy man out of an unholy world and make him holy, then put him back into that unholy world and keep him holy in it. Are you with me? Give God a praise. Come on, church. You have to understand, I grew up at the altar. As a boy, I went just because it'd get me out of trouble. Amen. My dad was a pastor, and I knew if I just went to the altar, he might forget what I did that day. Listen. But it was at 8 years old, laying in his lap at a youth camp, that the whole place had left, and I'm laying in his lap saying, Dad, I don't want to leave till I get the gift of the Spirit. And at 1 o'clock in the morning, tongues came out of this 8-year-old kid. What if we rebuilt the altars? Psalms 84 verse 3, even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself where she may have her young, a place near your altar, Lord Almighty, my King and my God. And you have to understand, I don't fit in. Pastor Mark does not fit in. We do not fit in the majority of churches anymore. Why? Because I have a problem. I love the altar call. In a day of microwave church, you can't have them. And it doesn't fit into the narrative being espoused from those who've grown comfortable with plastic faith and self-help talks and churches that no longer desire encounters over engineered experiential gratification. So you have to realize what I'm talking about. Dare we get so good at preaching and singing that we fall into the same lie as the angels did? They knew preaching. They heard him preach. They heard Father preach. They knew worship. But you have to understand, they walked away from it to chase after their own desires. And so 1/3 fell away. Those are the demons. And you need to realize that God says, I'm looking for those. And when I go into most churches, and the order of services that they hand me before a church service, when they have 3 or 4 or 5 services, the only thing that happens that day is me getting exhausted. And the order of service doesn't mention the altar call. Or I look at their bulletin for the week, and it never even mentions a prayer meeting or crying out time. I'm going, dear God, what have we done? And just as in the 1970s when Europe's churches began to die, here we are almost 50 years later, we're in the same spot. And when we're more concerned about the aesthetics than the anointing, we become a dwelling place for the wrong angels. And I don't want to go to any more plastic surgery hospitals. I want to go to an emergency room if I got cancer. Are you with me? You got to get this thing cut out. And I must hurry. Please forgive me. I've gone longer. No, I haven't. No, I've been with Pastor Mark. I haven't. I haven't. He's my favorite preacher. So, but we've allowed the inoculation of a powerful Savior that has been reduced to a societal hoax. Well, all the while he's screaming, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That's what he's saying. It's James chapter 4. Come near to God, who'll come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. You know what a double-minded person is? Not only is he unstable, he's on his way, but it means I can act like heaven on Sunday and act like hell on Monday. It means somewhere along the way I have been able to compartmentalize my God and treat him like Buddha. But there comes a moment where when you walk out of here, you are invading darkness. You walk out of here, you are drawing the attention of the enemy. You walk out of here, you're marching through the streets saying, I've got something I got to tell somebody about. I've got something inside of me. It's us sitting on planes lately, laying hands on people next to us on planes, because people can't run from you on planes. I want to be in a plane and get on somebody's nerves so bad they try to pop that door. But there's an understanding. I got to hurry. See, you got to realize there's a moment when God begins to move you and call you, and the day of what the world have to offer doesn't even call anymore. It gave up. You blocked its number on your phone. You just said, no, 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 you can't even call me anymore, because what I've tasted is so good. I can't be a part of that. And our mandate must be to rebuild the altar before it's too late. Elijah had this same mandate. Remember, Elijah was the John the Baptist of the Old Testament. His name meant judgment. And then Elisha, his name meant salvation. So it was John the Baptist and Jesus. That's why it tells us in Malachi chapter 4, verse 5, it says, I will send you the spirit of Elijah, or else I will curse the land. I'm going to turn the hearts of the fathers, children back to the fathers, or else a curse will come to the land. But then we're reminded of Romans chapter 11, verse 3, where it talks about Elijah with the day when he was fighting against the prophets of Baal and against Jezebel. Remember what happened to Jezebel? She got thrown out of a tower. You know what a Jezebel spirit is, right? It's still in the church. John the Revelator mentioned it in Revelation. Who's Jezebel? It's a controlling spirit. It's a demonic spirit. It doesn't like public attention. It gets its joy out of controlling people from behind the scenes and disrupting what God is trying to do in a church and stirring up dissension. And you can't have a Jezebel without having a wimpy little Ahab. And when I say Jezebel, I'm not talking about a lady, because I know that's what everybody wants. You got a Jezebel. No. It can be men. I've met him. It's an unbalanced marriage. Remember what happened to her? She gets thrown out of the towers. Her father-in-law's tower. Remember? Who threw her out? The eunuchs, because that's what a Jezebel spirit does. It removes manhood. They had enough. They threw her out of the tower. Jehu was anointed. Everybody's got a Jehu anointing inside of them. To throw out of the tower. Remember what happened? The dogs came to eat her, but they would not eat the palms of her hand, the soles of her feet, or her skull, because even a dog will not eat what you won't worship with. So here's Elijah. He's frustrated. Half the time he thought he was the only one left. I've been there. I've had those afternoons. Lord, the whole world's going to hell. Everybody. The Bible says in Romans 11, verse 3 through 6, Lord, they have killed your prophets. They've torn down your altars. I'm the only one left, and they're trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I've reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed to the knee to Baal. So too at the present time there is a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it cannot be based on works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. Oh, listen to me, because William Booth said it best, and he's one of my heroes. I've stood under the London Bridge where he heard the cries of humanity as an old man, and God changed him forever. And he started the Salvation Army, which, by the way, wasn't about ringing bells at Christmas to get money. It was an army that rose up to lead the world, and he, of darkest England, he mapped out how we could win all of England. I've got one of his original versions in my library. But he said the chief danger that confronts the coming century will be religion without the Holy Ghost, Christianity without Christ, forgiveness without repentance, salvation without regeneration, politics without God, and heaven without hell. Hello, America. I was reading Leonard Ravenhill a couple weeks ago, and all of a sudden he says, what we need now is a revival of holiness, a revival of character, a revival of people who are utterly selfless, prepared to lay their lives on the altar for God. Are you getting this? Why? Because the altar is the place where what you have been is interrupted by what you can become. I'm going to say it again. The altar is the place where what you have been is interrupted by what you can become. I'm going to say it again. The altar is the place where what I used to be gets interrupted what I'm about to become. The altar is the place where what I've been all these years suddenly gets an interruption by the Holy Ghost, an infusion by the power of God, where what I used to be doesn't matter anymore. Because I am a new creation. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. And so the loss of the altar call in the American church has caused the church to try to motivate the devil out of people. And what you got to realize, and I got to hurry, to remove the altar is to banish Jesus. The foundation of everything we do is about the altar. Are you still with me?
Yes.
Remember Genesis, garden, Genesis 3:15, the promise of redemption that was coming. He'll bruise the head. We know that Noah, we know that he built an altar. As soon as he landed on dry ground, what did he use to build the altar? The doors of the ark. In other words, the doors of what saved you is the place where God will go and do a work inside of you. But then, because he's man, he allowed vines to grow over his altar, and then he got drunk on the vines because he thought he did it. We know that Abraham laid Isaac on the altar. Everything we do is about the altar. I'm trying to show that to you. When God said, take your son, your only son, whom you love, and lay him on the altar. We love to lay what we hate on the altar, but there's a moment where you got to lay what you love on the altar. Remember when Isaac looked at him and said, where are we going, Father? And he said, we go worship. It's the first time you'll find worship in God's word. What you call sacrifice, God calls worship. 3-day journey, shadow and type of Christ, up the Mount of Moriah. See, you have to understand, there, everything we do is about the altar. That's why he gave them a mercy seat.
that inside of it had the Ten Commandments. It's a perfect church, by the way, if you ever study the Mercy Seat. In fact, our ministry was called Mercy Seat Ministries until last year when we officially changed the name to Remnant because the Lord said it's a new dispensation for us. But anyway, and so if you study the Mercy Seat, it's a perfect church. What do you mean? Inside was the Ten Commandments. Represents you got to have some law, especially for the way some of you drive, Cade. So I meant Joshua, forgive me. Last night we got to know a lot of people. Got real close to them. I was singing, I wish they'd all been ready. Anyway. I'm playing. It was fine. But you got to understand, it was Aaron's rod that budded, represented leadership. And the pot of manna, which represented blessing. But what was on it? The seat of God, the mercy seat. What was guarding the mercy seat? Two cherubs, two angels. Who is Jesus? He is the mercy seat. Where does he sit? Upon the mercy seat. What flows underneath, over the mercy seat? Blood. Where's my sins? Under the blood. Therefore, he's sitting down. I don't know about you, but last week we were on vacation, and I sat in a chair that somebody had left me a gift. And I got up and Karen said, you sat in something. I'm walking around like I was cool. And she goes, come here. In other words, if my sin's back here, is under him, he can no longer see my sin. But what you got to realize, the whole Bible is Leviticus 6:13. The fire must be kept burning on the altar continuously. It must not go out. The children of Israel continually built altars in the wilderness. Story after story, Jacob wrestled with God. He lived. He called it Peniel. God gave him a pillow to sleep on called a rock. And then what did he do? He went back and built an altar there. What we have done is we have forgotten the altar. We dance, we shout, we love great preaching, we love great word, but we have not learned to die. We have not learned to crawl up back in that place and say, I'm going to wait on the fire to come forth. Give him a shout. The prophets would go before the altar. The psalmists would write about the altar. The major and the minor, which bothers me. I don't know why they did that to them. Wrote the altar. It was man's continual search for redemption. So to remove the altar is to banish Jesus. What are you talking about, Pat? Job tried to give us a little hint. The oldest book of the Bible. He said, for I know my Goel, my Redeemer, purchaser of blood. I know my Redeemer liveth. Somebody's coming to buy me back. That's what the word redeem means, purchased by blood. Ransom. But the problem is we could not get to the altar. Only the Levitical order could. There was no way for us to get to the altar because we were separated by sin. The restrictions were unbearable. We needed a sacrifice worthy to get us free and get us back to the front of the altar call. We needed a Savior. How many of you understand Jesus can be seen throughout the entire Old Testament? Are you with me? Because the Old Testament is Christo-centered. The Old Testament was a declaration of what was to come. Jesus was a fulfillment of what happened. So you have to understand, all throughout the Old Testament, you can see Jesus in the background. He's the Lamb of God. He was a lamb that would be killed to cover the nakedness of man in the garden. He was a spotless lamb, a lamb that grows to become a male child. I'm almost done, so stay with me for a moment. And the blood of the lamb on a doorpost that would protect. It was the first helmet of salvation. It was all a part of a perfect plan to get us to the altar. It would be a perfect lamb's blood that would cover us and become personal. Finally, Isaiah would tell us, the prophet Isaiah would say, hey, it's not just a lamb, but it's a man. Isaiah 53, verse 7, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is silent. So he did not open his mouth. Then all of a sudden, Malachi told us, the Son of Righteousness will rise up with healing in his prayer life, the wings, the tallit, the bottom of the prayer shawl, healing in his wings. So you have to understand, that's why the woman with the issue of blood would reach out and touch the hem of his garment, and she would be radically healed. She didn't touch his robe. She touched his prayer life. He was a kosher Jew. He wore a prayer shawl. And then all of a sudden, John the Baptist would say,
he would declare, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the earth." And suddenly, Jesus would take center stage. The Lamb of God finally stood up. The entire Old Testament planned it out. The New Testament told us how it all happened. You got to understand, he couldn't come as God. He had to come wrapped in man, born, and go through the very doorways of life through a mother. Why? Because if he would have blown us away, it would have forced a response. He didn't want you to be robots or an animal that just counter to his commands. He wanted you to have a free will. So he came. And if he would have came in his glory, because his face shines and lights up the heavenlies, it would have blinded us. You need to realize. So he had to reduce himself down to a seed. Grow as a baby in the womb. Oh, it's getting good. Hold on. He gave up the ability to travel through time and thought. He gave up the greatest worship ever, the angels. He would face discouragement, pain, suffering, humiliation, weariness, loneliness, exhaustion. He humbled himself so that he could be touched by the feelings of our infirmities. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 through 16. Then he began to do miracles. John 21 says that all the books of the Bible could not hold, or all the books in the world could not hold the miracles he did on earth. Think about that next time you drop by the Library of Congress. From miracle to miracle, from water to wine, which we know that that's the first thing God does is want to restore joy to marriages, because it happened at a wedding, and the wine in the Jewish culture meant joy. So he was saying, let's put some joy in this marriage. By the way, it was a representation of what would happen in the upper room. He would take empty vessels and pour joy into them anyway. He would heal the leprous. He would raise the dead girl. Two fishes, five loaves, spitting in the eyes of a blind man, driving out demons, rescuing an adulterous woman, sitting on a well, preaching in the synagogue, overturning the tables, cursing the tree of no fruit. And it was all part of his process. He became poor, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, that I might become rich. It's an understanding that he did all this. And that's, and what's crazy about it, that's not even why he came. He was just chilling. He's just doing his thing. None of that was what he came to do. That's what he did to occupy. When he got ready to go to the cross, he rebuked everyone that tried to stop him, because they wanted to crown him and he wanted to be glorified. Big difference. Listen to me. Your altar is expensive. There's a price for your altar. Can I tell you what this altar cost? Next time you come down here and you treat it like it's nothing, because there was 8 stations to the cross, you need to realize that every single station was something that represented something powerful, that there was 8 places. Next time you walk down here and treat this like, I'm just going to do this so I can impress everybody, you need to realize the altar's expensive. Don't you dare treat this as a moment, because he went through 8 stations, from Pilate condemning him to Jesus taking up his cross. The 8 stations is pretty simple what he did. But some of us treat the altar like it's not important. When Simon, a slave, would pick up the cross and carry it for him, all the stations of the cross was leading up to yours and my redemption, to the point that Jesus speaks to the woman and he says, listen, don't weep for me, weep for your babies. And they stripped him of his garments, but they could not tear them, because the chief priest could not tear his robe. That's why Caiaphas tore his robe, to prove he wasn't the true high priest. Jesus was. And understanding that all the different places he would walk through, and then we know he's nailed to the tree. And the Bible says in Philippians 2:8, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Then he cares for his mother. Then he dies on the cross. And then he says the attitude of the cross: I thirst, I forgive, and it's finished. Until you do those 3 things, you'll never end up here. I thirst, I forgive, and it's finished. I thirst for you. I forgive those who have hurt me, because you only love Jesus as much as you love your worst enemy. And then you say, it's finished. I am done with this. I am done with the old. Forgetting what is behind me, I am pressing. I am pressing. I am pressing. I am pressing. I am. Some days the run is a little easier. Other days it's like I'm running through corn. It's that understanding that I am pressing. I ain't got nothing back there. So next time my past calls to me, I can't hear it, because I don't drive with a rear mirror. I drive forward. There's an understanding that God says, I am forgetting what is behind me. Why? Because you need to realize, behind me is not an altar. In front of me is my continual altar. The place where I stopped is it. Your family tree changed because of the tree. You realize that, right? That's why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him to be no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And his body became the access door. His body, that's what the Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 12, that by way of his body, I now don't have to wait on a fella to go in there. Hey, can you go make a sacrifice for me? Can you go kill a dove? I had a pretty good week. I need you to kill a cow this week. I had a really bad week. I can't come back for about a year because I got to buy a bull this time. No, but because of him, I'm able to come and crawl back up to the place. It's an understanding that he was my mediator in my covenant. It's an understanding that I needed a priest who actually got it. I needed a priest who understood what it was like at 12 years old to take a gun out of my mom's hand when she tried to commit suicide. I needed a priest that knew what it was like 9 years ago on August the 12th when I would stand over my sister's dead body. That's the fella I needed. That's why Hebrews 4 tells me that we don't have a priest that's out of touch. That means no matter what you've gone through this week, he was standing over you. He's sitting right there with you saying, it's okay. It's okay. Hold on. It's okay. That means he stood there with me. When we thought you had cancer this last year and you decided to praise, and then we found out there was no cancer. You go ahead and live normal. You know where I want to live? I want to live with scuffed up shoes and scabby knees because I continually get back to that place where I'm crawling before him. I want to be the one that outruns everybody at an altar call. I want to be the one that at the moment the first augmented note is hit on the keyboard, simultaneously letting the church know we've started the altar call. When the augmented note starts, I'm coming. He outran the village. He outran the village. What do you mean? We all love the story of the prodigal. But whether it was finding the sheep, leaving everybody else to go get the sheep, whether it was finding the rings so the marriage could take place, when we got to that point in Luke 15 where he says, he starts telling this story about this kid who really embarrassed the family because he went and spent his worth and his value in front of a bunch of Gentiles, which is against the law. He could never come home. He had embarrassed the family. In fact, the minute he came home, everyone in the village would run to him and do the kazaza, which is a Jewish traditional thing. It's where if a kid came home after embarrassing his family, the whole village would run out and they would take a pot of burnt corn and beans, and when the boy or the girl or whoever it was that had messed up came walking into the entrance of the village, they would run to them and they would look at him and they would break the pot. And that meant you are now a slave to this village. So when the Bible tells me in Luke 15... that he gets up from the pigs and says, I'm going to go back and be a slave. That's why he said that. But a lot of people don't understand this story because it says the father day and night's been standing there watching for him. Winter, summer, spring, and fall. Farms falling apart. And then all of a sudden, the Bible says when he was a long ways off, he takes off running. And the boy's thinking of excuses. Like, I'm going to say, I messed up here, Dad. I just,
But what did he do? The Bible says he runs to him. Do you know why he ran? He was out running the accusers. He was out running the village. He knew, if I don't get to him first, the village will accuse him and identify him and make him a slave. So he broke the law by running. A father did not run. So when all of a sudden the village looks up and sees this man running, he gets to his boy, falls on him, kisses him on the neck. And by the way, the only other time you'll find that term in the Bible is in the book of Acts when he fell on the upper room. And then the Bible says he takes, the servants are running beside him. And he puts clothes on him. Get dressed, get dressed, boy. Get dressed. Because when we walk in, I don't want them to see you for who you've been. I want them to know there's royalty walking back into this house. And we're going to have a party. And I'm putting new shoes on you and new clothes. That means while he was running, he had the clothes in hand. Oh, my garments. It's Isaiah. Though my garments be as scarlet, he makes them white as snow. He outran the village for bad. He outran the village for bad. Why are you so intense? Why do you think you can win 100,000 souls this year? I don't know. Maybe it's the sleep disorder called Revelation. But it's coming. Amen. And we're going to need your help because we got to launch a Remnant TV thing. So you're going to have to figure out how to help us. I'm done. Tie me to the altar. Tie me to your presence. I'm different from last year. I've had a year of frustration. It's not about gifts, man. I'm going to be, some of you will be bothered by this. It's not even about the anointing. Because the enemy loves to pervert anointing. It's about his presence. Draw near to me. I'll draw near to you. I'm waiting on you to just take, this is what he's saying. You take the first step. You wash your hands. You scrub your brain. You cleanse your heart. He outran the village for me. Next time you feel like a failure, realize he outran the village for you. All those accusers, he got to you first. That lying death spirit that was good, it was a day late, dollar early. Didn't have the authority. Because when he raptured you, when he took you in his arms, by the time the devil turned around, you were already dressed. He had already dressed you in a garment without accusation. I'm waiting on you to get fired up. I'm waiting on you to just stand to your feet and cry out to him. I'm waiting on you to cry out. He's been running towards this building. Go ahead and stand up. He's been running towards this building all night. Tie me to the altar. Tie me to the altar. Tie me. Bye.
was blind. Oh, but now I see. Amazing grace, how sweet. He saved a wretch. Oh, he saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now. Oh, I was blind. Grace that taught my heart to fear. Sake. Joy, just walk back in. Joy. Here it is. There it is. Joy didn't leave you. When we've been there 10,000 years, oh, it's bright shining. We know less days, we know less. Sunday de beke your soul. God, praise. I haven't sung this song in years. Praise. Oh, praise God. I can't give an altar call experience yet. The Lord says, hold on, not till desperation breaks out in the room. My team didn't know they would fly all the way here from Atlanta to have their own encounter. It's very selfish. I'm selfish about my encounters, man. I don't care. I'm teaching to be selfish about encounters. It's not that we don't have the anointing. It's just that we're too busy. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins. Don't know the rest. Holy Ghost about to hit the room in three phases. He just told me. I've never had him tell me this. Joy's hitting the room now. Joy. He just told me that. He said, I'm restoring joy. I'm restoring joy. 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 Yaranabasoka. Joy. Joy. He just told me three phases. Joy. 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 Sebekese. Sebekese. Joy, joy, joy. I've never had him tell me this. Joy, joy. The joy, 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 joy. Where? He's calling, second phase. He's calling. That's what he said. He said, I'll show you each key. Feel your glory. It's reaching out to me. I feel you pulling, pulling me into you. I feel your glory. See your glory, Lord. Lift your hands and say, Father. Touch me.
Touch me.
With the glory.
With the glory.
Ichabod is on me. Feels so heavy, yet I'm free. The weight of your glory's on me. Feels so heavy, yet I'm free.
There it is. It's coming like a wave now. Like a wave. The wave, the wave, the wave, the wave of the glory, 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 the wave of the glory. The wave of the glory, the wave of the glory. That la 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 ba sata. Sada la la ba. Sada la la ba. Sada la la ba. Kada la la ba.
Feel your glory. It's all around me. Crown me with your glory. Glory, glory. The invitation has been sent out. What's been taken will not compare to this present glory. Hear the sound of children coming home. I'm home, Mom and Dad, I'm home. I'm home, I'm home, I'm home, I'm home, I'm home. I'm home, I'm home, I'm home. Hear the sound of families being restored. Hey, 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 hey. Feel the glory. It's all around me. Hear the sound of hearts being sewn back together.
Some of you have had the inability to say goodbye to old covenant, and God says tonight, my glory will be enough to sustain you to say goodbye to it. Old things that broke your heart and crushed you or hurt you, God says, let it go now.
Hear the sound. Hear the sound of the glory coming in.
Sepik la 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 la, cry out, cry out, cry out, cry out. So da 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 da.
Hear the sound. That which was will be no more. It will be no more. That which was will be no more. It will be no more. Multiply my time on earth. Restore what the locust and cankerworm stole. Restore the headship of the house. Let your glory fall. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind can conceive the love of God. He's so wide, so deep, so high, you can't avoid him.
Thank you, Lord. Third wave. His goodness, the love of God draws us to repentance. Father, release upon this room. We've had the gift of joy. We've had the kabod. It's what you told me was going to happen. Now, Lord, everyone shut your eyes. Father, in Jesus' name, let them feel your arms around them now. Go. Rebe. Saka. Love of God, invade.
He's calling out to you. He's calling out to you. You were never alone.
That's it. Prophesy with that. Just start. Okay, Lord, this is so different.
It's another wave of joy coming now.
That's what he told me. I ain't never been through this. It's so different from what I do. This is really different.
Now the glory, glory of God fall. Sebekes. The glory. The glory of the Lord.
Now, this is what the Lord just showed me. God's about to lasso. Father's about to lasso each one of you. He's wrestled you. And now he's lassoing you. And when he releases the lasso in the spirit, he's pulling you down here, whether you like it or not. So this is what the Lord just showed me. This is such a weird time for me, I'm telling you. I've been messed up a lot lately, so I'm good with it. But the Lord's about to lasso you into his glory. And he's gonna send it out, and he's just going to go. He's going to break you down. He's going to tie up your feet. He's going to tie up the hooves. And he's going to tie you to the back of him so he can drag you a little bit. But it's on the backside. You get the revelation. Just ask Moses. So, all right, we're going to do something crazy because we're not done. See, the problem is I've lost weight. So I'm not as hungry as I used to be. I'll be fine. I used to be like, we got to get out of here. I got to go eat. But when the Lord lassos you into his glory, man, you know what? I've never been in a service like this where he just starts restoring joy again. Hold on. I'm sorry. He just told me. He said, let me fill him up with joy one more time, son. In Jesus' name.
Feel your glory. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Hello, wandering prophet. The Lord says he will never allow your feet The Lord has put tennis shoes on you, not iron boots that hold you down. You are called to run. Oh, you've asked God, don't let him put me in a box. Don't be in a box, Lord.
The Lord says you're never going to be in a box. He's handing you keys. Wow. You're not stationary, man. You are a mobile man. New lands, new territories, I tell you. What you call sometimes taking a step back, God says, every time you got to get on a plane, you got to go back to the same hub to go. I mean, if I thought of every week when I go to that Birmingham airport and wait in that line to get on that plane that I was taking a step back, I'd never get on a plane and go, feel your glory. Now here comes the Holy Ghost lasso. Ain't never done this before. Turn off the cameras. In Jesus' name, he's going to pull you to this altar. You're going to feel the Holy Ghost just dragging you. You ready? See, two-thirds of God's name is go, so I got to wait on the green light. All right, so that a la bakatai. Ah! Anime. Now, he's throwing the rope. He's pulling you. Come on. Come on, he's pulling you down. Come out where you're at. Come out where you're at and let the Lord just pull you down front. Ready? Come join me. Come join me down front. Come on, get out of your chairs. Let the Holy Ghost pull you down here. Come on. Come on, that's Holy Ghost. He's just going to pull you down. He's pulling you down. He's pulling you down. He's pulling you down. Yeah, da, 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 da. Come on, everybody, everybody. We're a whole bride. We're a bride. We're one bride. We're one bride. One bride. One bride. Feel your glory. God calls you the running man, Joshua. Those feet are fitted with readiness. Those feet are... Hey, Elizabeth, the Spirit of the Lord says that you're on the edge of your W-H-E-N, your win. Take one step forward. We will cry out. We will cry out. Cry out. Karen Sue, join me. Come here, babe. Iria deria so koyama. Seria cola la la basate. It's about to be a moment of repentance, but first, Karen, you got to pray over him because we've taken the altar for granted. Father says, I want you to desire the altar more than you desire the building. I want you to desire the altar more than the calling. I want you to desire the altar more than the blessing that comes from going to the altar. Just desire the altar. Go ahead, Karen.
Lord, we just pray right now, Lord, that there would be a presence, your presence, that would come into this place so thick, so mighty, so powerful, Lord. We desire one thing tonight, and that is to be in your presence. Lord, we desire to rest in your presence tonight. Lord, I pray that every single person in this place, Lord, that is longing, that is crying out for a deeper place with you. Lord, I pray that they be filled with power and might. Lord, I pray that you fill them up. Your spirit of joy, your gift of joy is overflowing in this place. Lord, there is a presence of peace that is in this place tonight. Lord, where the enemy has tried to bring turmoil, you are bringing peace tonight. You are bringing peace into their families, into their spirits, in the places where the enemy has brought confusion and has brought doubt and has robbed them. You are fulfilling the joy, fulfilling the promises. We declare freedom tonight. We declare and we receive your joy. We receive your gift. We receive your presence tonight. Fill us up to overflowing. Thank you, Jesus.
You amaze me. We're going to a new level. You know that, right? Okay. The table is set. Table's set, the Lord says. Now you're going to eat. Sustenance awaits you in his presence. If you have abused the altar, don't abuse the altar. Don't abuse the altar. Most churches, it's just a prop today. You can have an altar in your car. You can have an altar in your locker. You can have an altar in your cubicle at work. You can have an altar any place on the beach, in the mountains, in prison. Paul and Silas, it says they were taken into the inner court, which, by the way, if you ever study it, it's the same term for Holy of Holies. It really is. God wants to restore his altar in your life. He is not a part-time God, and he's not a God that you leave in your living room when you go to work or go to school. He is God. He said, keep the fire burning day and night. And even when it rained, the fire would suddenly go higher and lap up the rain. Ignite a fire in me, the all-consuming fire, the fire shut up in my bones, my cloud by day, my fire by night. If you have been lax with him, if you've allowed things in your life, then create an altar right in front of you. You don't have to get on your knees. You can do whatever you want. I don't care. But you can right now cry out to him and say, I repent, God. I forgot the altar. I forgot to take it before you, to cast my burdens upon you. I forgot, Lord, the power of the altar. Now begin to cry out, restore the altar, restore the altar. I repent. Tie me to the altar. Tie me to. Now hold on. take one step forward to the altar. Put your two hands out in front of you and lay your hands on the altar. Wash your hands. Lay them on the altar. They're right. The altar's right in front of you. They say that's weird. I know. Just like this. Just like. Just wait on him. We're going to wait a minute. Draw near to me. I'll draw near to you. Okay. All right. We're going to take your word. He's getting closer. He's in front of you. He's breathing on you. He's breathing on you. Breath of God, fill my soul. If you get close enough to him, you'll feel the tear on his cheek for lost humanity. Just whisper to him, tie me to the altar. Tie me tight, Father, so that I don't move. Now tell him, say, you are all I need.
Tie me to the altar. For I don't want to move. There's freedom at the altar. The place of rest restored.
Some of you gonna sleep tonight and you ain't slept in a long time. The Lord just said, some of you gonna get your rest back tonight. It's gonna restore time to you. Now pray this out loud in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
I will never
abuse the altar. How? Say, how?
How
can I abuse?
What I am tied to?
Hallelujah.
Tie me to the altar. Place where I'm restored.
Restore your remnant, Father. Joy, say back.
Sonderia cote. Sonderia so. I will forever be the altered. Sondere di Arone, Tie me to the place where I'm restored. Meet me at the altar. Heaven is an open door.
The seedbed of revival is in this house, I tell you. The Lord says you have been faithful to contend. What is coming can only be described as something that Father does so that when the accusers and the liars speak against it, their accusations will have no merit. It has always been this house. For better lack of words, I understand this for our ministry, don't we? It has been us against the world. But the Lord says there's more of you all over this city. Amen. The Lord's going to remove the wallpaper off the front of the church where they haven't been able to see you. They've drove by. They're going to begin to pull in. I'm telling you. I don't think you understand what I'm saying. I will never say something as thus saith the Lord unless it is. Because if you do that and it's not, it's witchcraft, man. I tell you, it's not worth it to me. But I'm telling you. I'm telling you. Dare you believe you're the only ones in this city? I hope not. For has he not hidden for himself 7,000? 7,000. Let every man be a liar. God does not lie. For he cannot lie. What you have seen is nothing that is coming. Now I'm going to tell you, you're going to have waves of glory hit you throughout the night in your bed. And joy, joy, joy. How many of you, has your house been under attack physically or financially or with physical attacks? Our house got attacked this week, didn't it? You got attacked, our grandson Jack. She don't look like grandmama, does she? But she is. And we start young in our house. And our whole family's been attacked, man. Sickness. And we believe in divine health. We believe in walking divine health. We really do. But how many of you have been under attack even financially? Okay. Say, you have the authority to stand on your front porch and call forth the angels who are sent to serve those who inherit salvation to bring in the finances and the healing. Learn your authority, the gift of faith. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 9. You have the authority to say, Lord, give me crazy ideas and dreams when I go to bed at night. Hey, I'm going to tell you something. God, if you align with the Father and you know his heart, he will blow your mind financially. I've been living in it for a year. A year. He told me I had a poverty spirit. God offended me. I said, Lord, I don't have a poverty spirit. I give everything away. He offended me. I should write a book called Why Is God So Mad at Me? Or Dehydrated. I'm one of those. When she was writing her book Dehydrated, I'd walk to the house and go, thirsty. And she'd go, I am Remnant. And so it's our family. We're really silly. We are. My son said to us last week, he did something goofy at supper. He said, there is no grace in our family. And so we're doing silly stuff. Anyway, the Lord spoke to me. He said, you have a poverty spirit. I said, Lord, I don't have poverty spirit. I give everything away. He said, exactly.
And then he said, poverty spirit is not just worrying that you got to get everything today because he can't take care of tomorrow. Jesus spoke against that in Matthew 6. But a poverty spirit is also not realizing how big your dad is. We have a policy in our family. If our son, our daughter-in-love Adrian calls, Abby, whatever, they need anything. If their motives are pure, they get it. It's yours. You can have it. How much greater does a father give to his children, the Bible says. And when you break that poverty mindset that you're not worthy of the blessing, or that he can't give you a brilliant idea, or he can't put the entrepreneur running on you, or you can't have streams of finances. I write about this. I mean, all right, I've been serious back on it because the Lord wrecked me last year. It was the first key to the kingdom. He said, rivers. There's four rivers in the Garden of Eden. Abraham added 8 streams of finances. I told our team, if we have to wait on the pulpit to go to the nations, we're never going to get there. He takes joy in your prosperity, gives you the ability to create wealth. Noah, knowing that it was going to rain, Hebrews 11:7, built an ark for his family. Hebrews 11:7. Hebrews 11:11 says, Sarah did what? She judged God what? Faithful. It's the only time God is judged in the Bible. He's judged faithful. That means every day you have to stand up in the middle of your living room and go, I judge you faithful. No matter what I'm facing, you're faithful. And then start expecting the miraculous. Doesn't mean you don't, he's called us to work. But God's not a social security system. He's not some government entitlement program either. He's God. And if you'll align your heart, your motives with his, better watch out. If he can trust you, the Lord spoke to me in October. He said, I trust you with wealth. I was getting ready one morning and I began to weep. He said, I trust you. It wrecked me. I had never heard the Lord say that to me. It wrecked me. Wealth for the kingdom. To shake nations. To build churches out in Oregon. To get on a plane and fly to nowhere, India. Where you could have died. And yet, that's what your pastors did. Here's what I'm saying to you. When you begin to understand the power of sowing and reaping, it changes everything. What's it about? What's your tag say on the back of your car? Live to give. Yeah. I stole it. I'm sorry. I took the tag. I know it's used. Well, then you're not living what it says. And so, no, I saw that and I thought, I love that tag. How come I never come up with anything cool? Mine's like 1B1245 or something. I don't know. Hey, you get to sow into this ministry tonight. Would you go back to your chairs for just a moment? Tie me to the altar. Can you write a song to this? I need you to write a song to this. Yeah. The place where I am healed. Pastor Joshua, come join me. I believe the priest of the house has the authority to do this. I want to tell you tonight, if the Lord speaks to you, if you decide to become a part of a partnership with this vision, you can get a card back there. We'll send you an email. Karen and I will pray over you every morning. We'll pray your name. And you get to be a part of seeing a harvest all over the world. And so it's called RaiseTheRemnant.com. But our team has a card back there. If you sow, we'll give you a book or CD series or T-shirt or whatever you want. But tonight, you're about to sow into this ministry, whatever the Lord speaks to you. Pastor Joshua, I love you guys. You don't want to miss tomorrow night.
So we want to sow into Pat and Karen Schatzline and the work that God has given them to do. Not that we desire a gift of you, but there might be fruit to your account. So just come forward as you purpose in your heart, as the Lord has stirred you. We just want to bless them. We want to just give as a token of that which the Lord has blessed us with and pour it out. If you need to make out a check, make it out to APM. Or Abiding Place Ministries. Everything that comes in tonight will go straight to Pastors Pat and Karen. So as soon as you're ready, just Just come forth and give. Oh, there's going to be such a miracle. Such a miracle provision. Such a miraculous multiplication. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.